Good morning, and welcome to worship this morning on this Ascension of Our Lord Sunday, time in the church year as we come to the come near the end of our season of Easter and the celebration of the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We remember that Jesus ascended, and what that means for us as God's people. As we go along in today's worship service, we will hear from the Gospels about what that is all about. Our worship service for this Sunday morning, for those of you here and those who are watching online, is essentially from setting number 3 of our Evangelical Lutheran worship book. And we begin our time together with our brief order of confession and forgiveness. If you'd all please rise with me as you are able. And as this is still the season of Easter, we begin with Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The Holy Spirit calls us together as the people of God in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. Know that in Christ, your sins are forgiven, and by God's grace, salvation is yours. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's join together in our gathering hymn, Christ is Alive.
Christ is alive, let Christians sing, the cross stands empty to earth.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, form the minds of your faithful people into your one will. Make us love what you command and desire what you promise, that amid all the changes of this world, our hearts may be fixed where true joy is found. Your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
Our first lesson comes to us from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus did and taught from the beginning until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." The word of the Lord. We will read Psalm 93, responsively, verses 1 through 5. The Lord is King. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He is girded with strength. He has established the world. It shall never be moved. Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their roaring. More majestic than the thunders of mighty waters, more majestic than the waves of the sea, majestic on high is the Lord. Your decrees are very sure. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore. The second lesson comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 15 through 23. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, and for this reason I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel for this Sunday morning is the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, beginning with verse 44.
Glory to you, O Lord.
And then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. And see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." And then he led them out as far as Bethany. and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they were continually in the temple blessing God. The Gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious and merciful God, for word of scripture on this day, we give you thanks and pray that you bless your word to our hearts, our minds, and to our spirits. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Ascension. To ascend. To be lifted up and away. As if we were talking about smoke rising up towards heaven, leaving behind the heat of the fire, to be carried away on the winds. That's ascension. To rise up. For Christ to ascend is to leave behind those poor disciples and followers. But it's interesting that at this point in the Gospel of Luke, whereas prior to the crucifixion and the resurrection in particular, the disciples, on hearing about their Savior going away, are terrified that somehow this by no means should be happening. Here on this spot after the resurrection, he has, as the writer points out, over a period of some 40 days after the resurrection, appeared to his disciples, showing them proof that it's really him, that he is really alive. And now at this point, when he finally ascends and disappears from their sight, ascends. His disciples are no longer afraid. They rejoice and they go back to Jerusalem, to the temple, the very place that is the greatest threat to their lives. I don't know if you noticed that. It's the greatest threat to their lives. That's where the group is that put Jesus to death. And if they figured out that they are with Jesus, and particularly now that rumors of Jesus rising again from the dead are circulating, those authorities don't like these disciples very much at all. They're going right back into the bowels of this darkness. What is going on? And I think they got it. I think here at this ascension of Christ, they finally got it. Oh, they would get more, mind you. Pentecost is still coming up, the 50 days after Passover. But now, at 40 days after the resurrection, they, I think, have it. That Christ opens the scriptures to them and shows them yet again that the one who is to come, the Messiah, is supposed to suffer and die, and on the third day rise. And that this is somehow in the heart and mind of God a singular and unified event, and this must be. And they get it. Oftentimes in the history of the church, I think that we didn't. And in some places too, I guess, maybe we still don't. Because too often in the past, because Christ ascends, we assume, like the ancients before the disciples, that heaven is far removed from us. That somehow when Christ ascends, he goes to some different place, up above. somewhere above the clouds, maybe just below the peak of the atmosphere, maybe near the ozone layer somewhere. That's where heaven is, the ozone. Lots of oxygen up there. Is that where Christ has ascended to? So that God, through Christ, in Christ, looks down on earth and there becomes the great judge, because this world is so corrupted, full of sin and darkness, that the risen Christ, the holy Christ, cannot ever suffer placing holy feet on this corrupt dirt again? It's easy to see, too, why in the history of the church we have given all of creation such a foul flavor, that our fight is somehow against nature, not for nature, to be stewards of it in the real sense. Because if Jesus has been removed and then Jesus comes again to create new heaven and earth, that must mean that this present one is terrible. And so we pillage the earth because there's no real concern for this earth. When we hear of global climate change, when we hear of pollution, when we hear of all of this that happens to God's creation, we simply say, don't worry about it. God's going to create a new one. But doesn't that destroy the intrinsic value, the value of God's own creation? Because we think that God is somehow removed and distant from creation. But here's the thing. When Jesus withdrew, the disciples worshipped him still and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple blessing God. They were still here. We are still here. Christ ascends, but if you remember from last week's gospel text in the Gospel of John, Jesus said, I am leaving and I am coming to you. And we talked a bit about last week about the notion that as Jesus leaves, he doesn't leave very far away. He leaves from here and goes here. Not very far at all. If you're short, that's hardly a foot. And the reason I say that is because Jesus does not remove himself that far. As he says, he leaves so that the promised advocate may come, the Holy Spirit. And it is the Holy Spirit of God who comes to, dare I say it, nestle into our hearts. As Jesus said, you follow me, my Father and I, we will come and we will make our home with you. Now, how far is this heaven that Jesus has ascended to you away from you? And if God sees the value, such great value in you, that God would make his home with you, in you, around you, and heaven has come to you, then where indeed is heaven? But wherever God is. And if Christ is within us through that work of the Holy Spirit, then heaven itself that we thought was so far and distant is not at all, but is right here with us. We walk as a part of it. We are called to be the hands and the feet of Christ, the voice of Christ. The one thing that Jesus told his disciples that was, I'm going now, but you know, hang around, go to Jerusalem, and in a few days you will receive the Holy Spirit. And at that point, everything will change. And then being that you are my witnesses, you will take this story of repentance and forgiveness to all the world. You will proclaim it everywhere. You will be afraid no more. Because you will know then that I am with you. And for these disciples, their stories, we don't have a lot of their stories about what happened afterwards in the scriptures, but there are certain legends that have floated around since that time, other writings that have suggested that every one of the disciples other than John, that's a good thing for our disciples named John, I guess, but all of the disciples except John were put to death, and the Apostle Paul as well. Fearlessly proclaiming this message of repentance and forgiveness, life through Christ. And so it is not that God sees a valueless earth and creation and will create a new one. No, quite the opposite. This is God's creation. Why would God hate the creation? No, there is certainly God's dislike of sinfulness. Those of you who joined in the Exodus Bible study online know that God sometimes gets right ripped. In the Old Testament book of Exodus, he is enraged when they build that golden calf. He's ready to snuff them all out. Moses says, oh, please relent. The word there is repent, believe it or not, to change your mind. And God does. Because God has other plans. God sees the line going far, much farther into the distance than even Moses did, I suspect. And here, in this moment, the line continues. And maybe Christ sees the line continue into the future far more than his disciples did. And sees in our time the line of history continuing into the future far more than we can. And so what our work now is with the ascended, risen Christ is to take heed of this work that he sets before his disciples. And if we are followers of Christ, knowing now that Christ has ripped open the barrier between heaven and earth itself, and now we, with Christ, are wherever heaven is. And the passing of this life is nothing more than going beyond that very thin veil now. But our work here, in this place is to be those stewards, not just of creation. Most certainly, we need to begin to fulfill that. But the stewardship of the message, the stewardship of the love that is to be poured out on all people, the loving of one's neighbor as ourselves. We confess every time we go through the confession and forgiveness at the beginning of the service that we haven't done that so well. And there is where forgiveness comes in. And then being spurred on by God's word to hopefully this week do better. To take heed of this command at the ascension of Jesus. Now you are my witnesses, Jesus says, to the disciples. And when we read this, he says it to us, you are my witnesses. Now you go and take this message of the risen Christ, and that repentance and forgiveness and new life, as Luke the gospel writer would write later in Acts, the lesson that Karen read this morning. Take this message. Be this message. Use words if necessary. But take it out there. For Christ is risen. Christ ascends. Christ with us. Through this holy, holy Spirit. Amen. Let's join together and celebrate in the words of our hymn of the day, Alleluia, sing to Jesus. Together in the confession of our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. Let's join together in our confession. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to God, the God of resurrection, for the church, people in need, and all of creation. We join our hearts and minds together in prayer. Holy God, make your people one as you and your Son are one. Fill us all with the joy of your presence as you and our Lord Jesus Christ make your home with us, and inspire us to proclaim your grace and mercy to all. A gospel of repentance and forgiveness of sin and of life everlasting. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Make worthy the work of scientists who look to the stars and planets in the heavens, as well as scientists who look to atoms and molecules. Bring innovation and well-being to humanity through their discoveries. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Keep in our minds those who have died in war, both military and civilians. Bring peace to places like Ukraine, Ethiopia, and the many other places that threaten the well-being of people around the world. May we honor them by seeking peaceful solutions to the conflicts that arise among nations and peoples. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Encourage all of us in Canada to bring about a just reconciliation with our Indigenous brothers and sisters. Heal the old wounds. Bring new and open attitudes. And as you rise to heaven itself, may the presence of your kingdom bear fruit in new kinds of relationships. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for our neighbors to the south and the tragic shootings in Texas, another in a long stream of shootings by those whose hearts and spirits have been twisted by some evil. May healing begin for our neighbors. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As we begin to feel the effects of climate change, fill our hearts with the love of stewardship for all creation, for each other, for this world, and for our faith. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear now, O God, the prayers of each of our hearts, the prayers that have been brought before us. Hear our prayers. We pray this in Jesus' name. Gracious God, unite us with the saints who have died and have been raised in Jesus Christ. Train us to wait with eager longing for Christ to come again, even as we sense his presence with us now. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
I invite you to share the peace of the Lord with one another. Peace be with you, Nadine. Yes, thank you, Spock. I heard that, Don. As we come to our time of offerings, a note for those of you who are here, our offering plates are in the middle of the aisle towards the back. I encourage you to deposit your offerings there at some point this morning. For those of you at home, we still do continue to welcome offerings through e-transfer and through automated deposit and by regular mail. We are certainly thankful for all of the offerings that we receive. They are for the work of Good Shepherd and the larger church through Good Shepherd as well. And so we do pray that you continue to bless us with your gifts. Let's join together in singing our offering song, Bind Us Together. Please rise. Right, our duty and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with all the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Amen. Amen. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We give you thanks, Almighty God, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these, your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Now, gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. Deliver us from evil. The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Come and eat at the table of the Lord.
Mercy on us, Lamb of God.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace, now and to everlasting life. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, our generous God, for in this bread and cup we have tasted the new heaven and earth, where hunger and thirst are no more. Send us from this table as witnesses to the resurrection, that through our lives, all may know life in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's join together in our sending song, "The Lord Now Sends Us Forth."
If any of the children would like to come up and take an instrument, this is a really nice peppy song for you to shake or rattle. Shake and rattle, knock.
The angels are upset.
I didn't need one of those instruments. I just shook my hips a little bit, and it sounded the same. Please receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated for a few brief announcements. First of all, a thank you is extended to you, the people of Good Shepherd, from the Synod. The Synod had an event here yesterday, and they very much appreciate the use of the facility. We had a couple of our own people that participated in the event. It was an all-areas gathering, so people were coming from all over our Synod, even some from very far away, that overnighted in Edmonton to come the rest of the way yesterday. So people were coming from all over to take part. It was great to have an in-person event of the Synod again. It was live-streamed as well, and so it was kind of a hybrid presentation. But it was a marvelous thing to come together. And so a thank you to all of you for opening up this this congregation, this building, for the work of the larger Synod. For this upcoming week, there's, I guess, not a lot that's going on this week as far as set events are going. But just a couple of notes. First of all, next Sunday is a very special Sunday. It's not just Pentecost Sunday, which is special in and of itself, but it's also Confirmation Sunday, and we'll be rejoicing with three of our confirmants. Would have been four, but the young fellow is actually a young fellow from Saskatchewan, and he will be heading back there to be confirmed in his own home congregation. And the three, I think you'll find in your bulletin, the names of our three that are going to be confirmed next Sunday. Do come out for that. Mark it off on your calendar. It's a great celebration in their life of faith as well. Next confirmation class for our confirmation kids is June the 8th. That will be the last one of the season. And you'll be getting a very special exam. Okay, there'll be other things too, but you know, it'll all be fun. It's the last one of the season, so mark that off for our confirmation parents and our students. Vacation Bible School. The theme for this summer's Vacation Bible School, which runs July 4 to 8, is Kings of the North Castle.
Knights.
Oh, yeah, not kings, knights. Knights, yes. Knights. There was a K in there somewhere. Knights of the North Castle. Registration forms are available in the narthex. Do tap your kids, your grandkids on the shoulder and make sure that they get here for that. It's going to run daily from 9 a.m. to noon, Monday through Friday. So mark that off. It's going to be a wonderful time. And first in a few years for Good Shepherd running our own along with St. Leonard's and St. Luke's Anglican churches as well. So it's going to be a lot of fun. Are there any other important announcements that need to be made this morning? If there is nothing else, then please rise. Now, go in peace to love and serve the risen Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Mm-hmm.